forevermore will be. He opened the prison door, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory.
Kings chapter 8 and verse 7. And last week we were talking, the first week I was actually speaking about how you know, that we should be vessels of honor, and that God is rising up. And sometimes you can be a vessel of honor, you need to be a vessel of honor, but sometimes God can, if you're not willing and you're not doing what God wants, you can also be turned into a vessel of dishonor or of destruction. You know, we were looking at that. And then we were also talking last week about how judgment starts in the house of the Lord now. And I was saying the prophet's stare continues. And this morning I just want to continue on that same story, just using the story again. And he's still staring. You know, I believe that we are going through a time in the church right now where, and I believe in the body of Christ. Last week I was saying that judgment starts in the house of the Lord, where God is busy purifying his church. He's getting a remnant ready. This week, Renee has been, she looked at T.D. Jakes and where he was talking about the remnant and how God takes care of the remain. You know, many times in a church, you will have a lot of people. Things might happen. Maybe God comes, God brings judgment, God brings things. And then there are some that remains. And I believe that in the church after COVID and all these things, There's a remainder of people that are still serving God, that's still moving forward, that's still trusting the Lord. And many times the remainder, I think in the story, T.D. Jakes is telling how he went to, his mom usually took him to a clothing shop or a material shop where they bought materials. And he always thought she was taking him there to buy these new materials. But every time they went there, she had to go into this place and buy all the remainder, all the materials that were left over. And she had to take him with as a mannequin to see if it will fit him so that she can make clothes for him. So she always used the remainder of those things. And he was talking how the remainder is important. You know, and so many times we will look over the remaining. And in the church as a pastor, many times something that I've also learned is that don't always cry about the people that are leaving. Don't always cry about those that are not there. Don't always look for the ones that are not there. Be careful and look at the ones that you have. Look at the remainder. You know, and in a church, I believe many times you will have times where things will jump up and sprout and grow. And at some point you will have times where it shrinks, where it, where the God is working on the remainder, those that are left over. And those are the ones I believe that God raises up. Many times God has to cleanse, many times God has to purify so that he can build a better foundation, you know, lay a better foundation so that he can build on that, so that he can grow his church and build a remnant, build a people that will remain, that will stay, that are faithful, that he's not shaken by circumstances or whatever, you know. So this morning I want to speak to you just quickly our story about 2 Kings 8 verse 9. You remember the story where I was talking about King Ahab that was sick, and he sent Ahaziel, his official, to the prophet Elisha, and he sent him there to inquire of him if he was going to live. And then he went, and when he came to the prophet, he asked him, the king asked if he's going to live. And he brought him 40 camels of presents and goods and all the stuff from their country. And the Bible says that Elisha said to him, the king will live, but in fact he will die. And we saw in the story that Elisha stared and he looked at Ahaziel. He stared at him. You see, he came for the message. He came to hear and inquire for the king. But at the end of the day, God was looking at him through the prophet Elisha. He was staring at him to the point where Ahaziel became so, kind of embarrassed, says the Bible, and he looked away, because the prophet was staring at him. And when he looked away, he was wondering what was going on. And we see in the story how the prophet started crying, and he told him that he sees the things that he was going to do to Israel. And we were talking how Ahaziel became a vessel that God used, like Pharaoh was a vessel that God used to destroy and to harden his heart against Israel. And we saw how he used Ahaziel to come and bring judgment on Israel. So the whole story around that, and how the prophet cried, and how he was hurt in his heart, and he saw what Ahaziel was going to do. And then the story continues how Ahaziel went, and he went back to the king, even though the prophet spoke to him, even though the prophet warned him and told him that there was things in his heart, even though he was convicted by the prophet and by the Spirit of the Lord, he still went. And eventually he took a cloth and he put it over the king Ahab's face, a wet cloth, and he smothered him, he killed him. And it's like a killing spirit, a murdering spirit that was upon him. And later on he did what the prophet said he would do. So just in that story, the prophet looked at him and he saw what he was doing. And Ahaziel means God sees. So God has seen through the prophet. His name was God Sees. And God showed through his name, there was a prophecy upon his life that where he came to the prophet and the prophet looked at him and saw that what he was going to do in his life. And in the same way, the Bible says God is God, he's El Roy, the God who sees. All right, just to recap quickly on the story that we're working from. So I believe that today God is busy looking at the church. There's a time now where God is looking at the church, intensely focusing his gaze upon the church, where he's getting the church ready. He is preparing a remnant. He's purifying the church. He is bringing the church into a place right now we are seeing where the church is looking at itself, where God is kind of staring. Embarrassment is coming. A lot of places in the church today we hear of ministers repenting and all these kinds of things. And people are just turning back to God, turning in a way. So the focus has turned from the people and everything else. God has turned his focus on the church. And he's looking at the church. He's purifying the church. He's cleansing the church. And for the last 3 weeks, God has got me on this track with this kind of message. And I actually wanted to, last week I wanted to bring you an encouraging message and something that will stir you up and build you up. But eventually I came back again with a strong message. And this week I said, Lord, I don't want to continue speaking on this. I want to come back with an encouraging word or something that will stir their faith and build them up or whatever. But the Lord brought me again last night. I was sleeping. This morning I prepared a little bit of my message, but I just didn't feel like what I was preparing was what I wanted to do. And as I woke up this morning, I had like a vision in my spirit, and I saw this big white horse, and it was running through the water, and it came running through the water with armor and everything on the soldier, and he came through the water, and it splashed open like that, and I saw this song coming. There was a song, I think in the 80s, 90s, where the Brownsville Revival, where they sang a song. It starts with, he's got fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand, and he's riding a white horse all across this land. You know, and I went and I read that in Revelations 19. He's riding a white horse all across this land, and he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me? You know, and this song carries on, and it's so powerful, the song, when you hear it. And it's a cry to the church, and he's calling out to the church, will you ride with me? He's got fire in his eyes. You know, it's like God has got, there's a blaze of fire. He talks about the passion. He talks about how he is seeing, how he, that kind of stare that the prophet Elisha had, where he saw and he looked and he was kind of gazing upon the church, and he says, will you rise with me? There's fire in his eyes as his encouragement, as a strengthening, as a seeing that he is going across this land. And the Bible talks in Revelation how he defeated the evil one, and he talks about the Antichrist and all these things, and how God defeated him. It was right at the end of the time of the church. You know, and I believe that today we are so focused on the now. We are so focused on where we are at. And what's happening in the church is that we are so focused on one another. You know, in the church we are so focused on the things that we are experiencing. But when I read this song, and when I heard this, saw this man, this horse riding through the waters, I saw this whole powerful message coming forth from that, where he says, our struggles is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this darkness, and against all the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. You know, and I looked at that scripture, and that just came to my mind, that our fight is not against flesh and blood, and that God is raising up an army in this day that's going to move into a new dimension, a new power, a new authority, you know. But before that can happen, I believe that God is busy looking at our characters. I believe that the move of God in this day is character. God is busy speaking to the church about its character. He's teaching the church where they've gone wrong. He's reflecting. Last week I said it's like a man looking in the mirror intently, staring into the mirror. And when he looks away, he forgot what he looked like. You know, that you need to look into the mirror and see yourself, who you are, what you are, what is going on in your life, where are you at this moment? And God is busy working with his church. He's bringing us to reality. He's bringing us to a place where we see ourselves for what we are. And we need to be careful what we will see. Many of us will not like what we see. But it's necessary to go through this. So I want to start this morning in Malachi chapter 3 and verse 2. He says, but who may abide? Who may abide the day of his coming? And who shall stand when he appeareth? For he is like a refiner's fire and like a launderer's soap. Who will stand? This translation just gives it difficult. But he says, who will abide at the day of his coming? Who will stand in the day of his coming? Says the Bible, and who shall stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and a launderer's soap. You see, I believe that we are in a time now where God is coming like a refiner's fire. And you know, a refiner's fire is to refine the gold. You put the gold in a bucket and then they put it on the fire. And as the fire burns, it brings up all the dirt in that gold. And as the dirt comes up, then they take a spoon and they take the dirt off the top of the gold and they throw it on the side. And as they continue to boil the water, as they continue to burn it, refine it with the fire, the more the impurities come out. You know, and I believe that as the church, we are in a place where God is refining us as with fire. The Bible says, or as a launderer's soap, where he washes the washing with his soap. And in those days, they washed with their hands. I know many times in the old days, they washed with this green sunlight soap. And they had the basin, I don't know if you've ever seen it, with the riffles on the inside. And they put the washing there, and then they wash it, the launderer's soap. It's being scrubbed and washed, you know. And that is what I believe God is doing in the church in this time. He's coming as a refiner's fire to purify, to bring out the dirt, to bring it to the surface, or like a launderer's soap, washing us clean. And that is a process. You know, lately we've been talking in our VIP courses and with our leaders, we've been talking about the processes that God is taking us through. You know, and sometimes you just need to stay in the process. So many times we want to get out of the process. We want to get out of what God is doing. And sometimes you need to stay in the process so that God can wash you, so that God can purify you, so that He can cleanse you, so that He can prepare you, so that He can harden you, you know, make you strong, firm, and steadfast, so that you can come into the place where God can use you as a vessel of honor, a pure and clean, and ready to be used, you know. So He's a refiner's fire. And as a launderer's soap, He says, who will stand? He says, and who will stand when He appears? For He is like a refiner's fire. Who will stand? And I believe that we are entering, or we're in a time where we are learning to stand. I believe that as I look at whatever is happening around us, we had people this month that were looking for a place to stay. And we had situations where people are going through financial difficulty. The food prices are going up. Everything is difficult, and many people are experiencing pressure. They are experiencing difficulty. They're experiencing all kinds of stuff in business. You're experiencing difficulty. Wherever it is, it's like this launderer's soap or this refiner's fire is burning, and it's touching our lives. And we need to allow God in this process, because He's teaching us to stand. He's teaching us to become strong, firm, and steadfast. So 2 Corinthians 10 verse 4 says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. 2 Corinthians 10 verse 4. He says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. This morning I don't have very powerful scriptures, scriptures that you've never heard before. I've got a simple word, simple scriptures, and a simple message. The Bible says that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are not fleshly. And we are living in a day right now where carnality has taken over in the church. Fleshliness has taken over in the world. People are living carnal lives where it's all about the now. We see it everywhere. Where people are living a life where they want everything now. Instant gratification. They live on the internet. They can just go onto eBay and order something. And they deliver it at their house. You can call any place and order a pizza and they deliver at your house. You can even call Checkers and they deliver your groceries at your house. Instant. Everything is easy. Ah, say Andre, no. They can deliver it at your house. Everything is instant, you know. So God is busy. I believe that in the world we have people that are growing up in this time, and with this whole COVID and everything, people have learned new ways of getting themselves in comfort, and we are surrounded by so much comfort. And then also what it says here, that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. So this morning, I just want to share with you for a few minutes, you know, about the carnality in the hearts of people, the carnality in the church, the carnality. At this point, I believe in many areas of our lives, people are trying to do everything in the flesh. And I believe before God moves, we need to deal with our flesh. We need to deal with our carnality, doing everything in our own strength, trying in our own ability. And we need to start relying on the Lord. He says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, for the pulling down of strongholds. So carnality will not empower you to pull down strongholds. Carnality will not empower you to overcome the enemy. Carnality will not empower you to be victorious in attack. Amen? So we need to deal with carnality in the church. We need to deal with the flesh. We need to deal with our own strength. We need to deal with our own ability. And we need to start focusing on God and realizing that He is the one that gives us the ability, that we are mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds. That you are mighty through God, not in your own strength. James 4 and verse 7. This week I hear everywhere people are talking about James. James 4 and verse 7, he says, submit yourselves. I believe that we must submit ourselves. You know, you don't have to be forced to submit. I don't have to force you to submit to the Word of God. God doesn't have to force you to submit to His will and to His plan and to His purpose. He says, submit yourselves then to God. You see, we need to come to the place where we submit ourselves. Say, Lord, I humble myself under your mighty hand, we said last week, so that in due time you will lift us up. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil. Submit yourself. Think about that this morning. Submit yourself. Come under the rule of God. Come under the authority of God. Come under the power of God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you is a promise. Then you will resist. But if you come carnally, you will not be able to resist the devil. If you do not bring your flesh under submission, you will not be able to resist the devil. And today we see the devil coming into people's lives. He comes and he destroys, he steals, he kills, and he destroys. But if you do not submit yourselves then to God, you will not be able to resist the devil, and he will not flee from you.
Yes.
Very simple, but very powerful. Very simple, but a revelation this morning. Submit yourselves. You see, and I believe when we start submitting ourselves to the will and the purpose and in the process of God in our lives, then we will be able to resist the devil. There's so many sicknesses, so many demonic attacks, so many things upon the lives of people like you've never seen before in this time. It's been released in this last few years. It's been released over the earth. There's such a carnal way about people. The people are fighting for themselves. You know, and when you go through difficult times and struggles, that is when your carnality comes out. That is when your fleshliness comes out. When you face trials of many kinds, like he says in James, that is when your carnality comes out. That is when you are revealed. So you need to submit yourself to God. You need to resist the devil. Resist that urge to do it yourself. Resist that urge to want to stand for yourself and fight for yourself. Resist the devil, says the Bible, and he will flee from you. But first, you need to submit yourself. Say, Lord, I come under your rule. Lord, I repent. Father, I ask you, forgive me. Father, I ask you, purify me. Take away what needs to be taken away. Come and cleanse me. Heal me. I submit myself to you. And after you've done that, you will resist the devil and he will flee from you. Amen. Then Ephesians 6 verse 13 that I was reading now, just now. Let's just look at that quickly about the full armor of God. He says Ephesians 6 verse 13. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. Again. It's not carnal. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood. And I believe in the church we have made our struggle against flesh and blood. Last week we said you fight and you quarrel and you do not get what you want because you pray with wrong motives. You want but you cannot have because you ask with wrong motives. You see, everything, the church, God is moving his church from carnality to spirituality.
Amen.
God is busy, he's moving his church from fleshliness to becoming spiritual, becoming mature. He says, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but somehow we as the church has made our struggle against flesh and blood. We are fighting one another. We are fighting the people around us. We are fighting the church. We are fighting the pastors. Today you look on internet and everywhere you listen, everywhere you hear, it's just how people are attacking the church, attacking pastors. You know, lately what I've heard, and I mean, I'm not a prosperity preacher. And a lot of people are fighting the prosperity preachers and coming against the prosperity movement, you know. And this week I was thinking about that, you know, and I'm kind of a person, I believe in a balance. I believe that God has a purpose for everything under the sun. And there was a time where the prosperity message was preached. But let me just give you a little bit of background that many people don't understand when they stand and judge the prosperity movement. You know, because just before that, in the 60s and 70s, there was a move in the church where all the churches were non profit organization. So what it means is that if a church has got an income, whatever comes in, they were not supposed to show any profit. So it was a non-profit organization. Are you following me? Is this making sense that I'm talking about? I just want to teach you a little bit of something. So what we see is that most of churches were non-profit organizations, so they were not allowed to show any profit. At the end of the month, when all their books are done, or every year, when they hand in their taxes, they were supposed to be a non-profit organization. They were supposed to show no profit. So they were not allowed to make any money, not to be blessed. In those days, the churches were ruled by deacons and elders and by a church board. So every church had its place, and there was a board that ruled the whole church. And they gave the pastor a salary, and they said so much as they actually just give him a house. They gave him food for him to eat, and then they also gave him a car and a petrol allowance and everything. So the pastor had everything set up. It was very nice. Today, a lot of churches are still like that. It's very easy. It's very nice. So many people stepped into the ministry because it's easy. You get a house, you get a car, you get a nice wife. In a church, many to choose from. You get a nice wife, so you get a nice house, and there you are, and you just live a nice life, you know. And then when you move from this church, when they close or something, when you're tired of this church after 3 years, then they move you to another church. And you go to a new town, and you do that church again, and you preach all your same sermons over again. And then when all that is done and people get tired of you, then they move you to another church and they bring someone else in again. And that's how they circled the pastors in the church. And sometimes it felt like they were hirelings, you know. They were just there for the money, for the comfort or so on. But at the same time, I don't know why I got into that now. That was not my the train of thought when I started out, you know. But that's kind of what happened. And then God came and he brought this whole prosperity movement where God was teaching his people. Because you see, in those days where the deacons and the elders were ruling the church, they kind of, we always teased and we said they had this saying that said, Lord, and this prayer, they go into intercession and pray, and they pray and they say, Lord, you keep him humble and we will keep him poor. You know, you keep him humble, we'll keep him poor. It was kind of if they were in that state where the prophet, where the pastor were not supposed to show any profit. He was at the end of the year, there must be no profit in the church, no profit in. So the church just did its thing. All right? So then the prosperity movement came. And when God starts something, if you, Rick Godwin said, if you want to get a plane in the air, you need to give it full throttle. Take that plane and you give it full throttle for it, and then it goes up and it climbs until it reaches the height that it needs and the speed that it needs. Then you pull back on that throttle and then it just glides on a little bit of engine power and it saves a lot of fuel. The same thing with a boat, the same thing with a car. You need to accelerate it to get it moving. Now in the church, I believe with the prosperity movement, there was an acceleration of God showing the church that he doesn't want us to be poor. He doesn't want us to be the least. He doesn't want us to be non-profit. He doesn't want us to be controlled by deacons and elders and by churches and fall into systems that are easy to control. And then in those days, a lot of ministers stepped out in the 90s and the 80s, they stepped out and they started their own ministries. They started coming out under the control of the deacons and the elders. They started coming out under the control of people. They started coming out under the control of the financial burden of just having enough to get by. And they started doing things for the Lord. They started stepping out. They started teaching that we should be blessed. That we are blessed. That we are prosperous. That God wants to prosper his people. They started using Deuteronomy 28, blessed you will be in the field, and blessed will be your basket and your kneading through, and you will be blessed. An enemy will come against you on one road and go before you on seven. And they started bringing in the blessings of Abraham, that God, and they started teaching the church that we need to be blessed. But where they've gone wrong later on was, if you're not blessed, then you are not God is not with you. You know, and then arrogance came. If you're not blessed, then God is not with you. If you're not blessed, you have sin in your life. If you're not blessed, so we got judged because of what we are doing, where we do not have blessing. And there are many people like Paul. He chose to live for God. He didn't care about houses. He didn't care about a place to stay. For him, it was Christ. For me, to live is Christ and to die is gain, Paul said. You know, he chose to live a life where nothing mattered except expanding and growing the church. And that is the right attitude we should have. But in the prosperity movement, it became like, if you were not having, you did not have a 10,000 seated church or 3,000 seated church, then you were not blessed. And that is not true. So in every message, there's always something powerful that God releases, but there's also sometimes we go into area when we go into extreme. And I believe that that is where they've gone wrong. But it's not that they are wrong. It's just there's an overemphasis on things that are not really necessary. But let me just continue. The Bible says, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, this world's darkness, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. So our struggle is not against flesh and blood. And somehow, now I'm hearing how people are judging the church, and they're judging the prosperity movement, and they're judging healings, and they're judging all kinds of stuff. And who has made them God to judge everything? You know, today everyone can get on internet or on social media and they can say whatever they want to in judgment on anybody and anything just as they want to. Everyone has got freedom of speech to say whatever they want to. Who made them God? Let me tell you that there are men that has gone before us that has done greater things than we have ever done. Who are we to judge them? I think that we need to be quiet. I always say, if I have not done more than Benny Hinn, then I don't have anything to say about him. If I have not done more than T.D. Jakes, then I don't have anything to say. And now I'm going to slaughter a holy cow today. If I haven't done more than Joel Osteen, then I've got nothing to say about him. You know, and I this morning when I was sitting here, I thought, and my spirit, it came up that God said, I must tell the church, and I must tell you pastors, stop defending yourself. Because you have brought a move into the church that was needed for its time. Yes, and God is shifting it. God is changing things. God is bringing us into an even playing field. God is bringing us into a place where we are busy moving into the balance of things. You know, so stop defending yourselves. I believe that that was the time. Now God is moving into a time where He's purifying His church. It's getting us to a place where we come into the fullness of Christ. We are taking up the full stature of Christ. Where it's not about money anymore, about being rich, being blessed, having the biggest church, or having the nicest car. The way you compare yourself with other people by yourself, like the Bible says, you know. It's not about comparison. It's about the heart. And if your heart is right before God, you will be blessed. If your heart is right before God, He will move in your life. Yes. If your heart is right before God, and if you trust Him and you put your faith in Him, He will heal you. He will set you free. He will deliver you. It's not about the physical. It's not carnal, but it's mighty through God. And I believe that God is busy revealing His power. He's bringing His power back into the church. Amen. So he continues in verse 13. Let me read it. Therefore, take up the full armor of God. And this is Ephesians 6. You know this scripture by heart. Take up the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes. How many of you know that we are in the day of evil? How many of you know that we are in the day of evil today? He says, when the day of evil comes, you will be able to stand your ground. And having done everything to stand, stand firm then. I wrote here on my note, on that scripture, you better be able to stand.
Amen.
Amen. Because so many people think that the wishy-washy way that we serve God is going to bring us somewhere. It's going to move the hand of God. It's going to move the earth. It's going to do something. I'm telling you, the Bible says, therefore, take up the full armor of God So that when the day of evil comes, we are in that day, you will be able to stand your ground. And having done everything to stand, you better be able to stand firm there. And listen to it. I'm going to read it in that context. You better be able to stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled. You better have truth buckled around your waist. You better have some word in you. You better have some truth that you stand on. Not what everyone else says. Like I was saying a few weeks ago, Peter said that Jesus asked, "Who do they say I am?" And Peter said, "You are the Christ." Some say a prophet, some say that, but you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You need to have your own truth buckled around your waist. You cannot walk on the truth of others. You cannot preach on the truth of others. You need to have your own truth buckled around your waist. You see, and that's why I believe in this church. Lately I've heard how people have, when I hear you guys speak, I hear how you talk now about James. How you talk about, Bianca was speaking online and she blessed me so much when she said, "I don't want to miss my call." That is so powerful. In everything she said that morning, that blessed me the most. Because at least, even if I've just done a little bit in her life over the 2 years, at least she realized she's got a calling. And she wants to fulfill that calling no matter what. And even being shy, she will go online and speak. That is powerful. Let me tell you, that moved me so much. Bianca, I'm telling you, I'm proud of you, man. You know, saying, "Lord, I don't want to miss my calling." That's the heart you should have. I don't want to miss my calling. Jeanne has been getting up lately and started moving and coming like these testimonies, speaking to people, getting people to go and pray for people. She doesn't have everything, but she uses who she can. Amen. To say, "Listen, maybe I can't pray for them, but will you go?" And Chameleon went, and people are going, you know. And that's what I love about what God is doing in our church. I will rather work with a remnant, a few, and have a few powerful people. A Gideon's army, 300, that's strong enough, that was willing to do something, than sitting with 1,000 that are just eating and becoming fat. Sorry, I didn't plan on saying that. He says, you better be able to stand firm then with the belt of truth. You need to have your own truths, your own beliefs, your own things that you are working for towards. You cannot just work for your church's vision. You cannot just work for your own vision, your own life. You need to have truth that is buckled around your waist. Buckled means you've put it on.
Amen.
You make it secure. It's buckled around your waist. No one can take it off. No one will rip it off. When I'm in this battle, it's buckled around my waist. And that belt of truth is carrying a sword. It's carrying some water. It's carrying maybe some stones like David had with his slingshot. You need to have some truth. You better have some truth buckled around your waist. When with the breastplate of righteousness in place. You better have some righteousness in place. You better have some righteousness in place. Righteousness means to be in right standing with God. You better have some righteousness in place. That you have grown to a place where you are righteous before God. You are standing right before God. You know who you are in Christ. Where you have grown out of sinfulness and weakness and all these things into righteousness. You see, God is busy raising up a church of righteousness. Not fakeness, flawless, full of flaws, fleshly, but a church of righteousness. So you better have some righteousness in place. And the Bible calls it a breastplate. See, a breastplate protects your vital organs. When the enemy wants to kill you, he cannot hurt your vital organs. He might cut your arm, he might cut your leg, he might cut you somewhere, but you can still keep on fighting with the other two legs and the other arm. But your vital organs are protected. So a breastplate of righteousness protects you. And with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace, you better have the gospel of peace in your life. Not the gospel of hatred, not the gospel of breaking people down, not the gospel of criticism, not the gospel of anger and fighting and quarreling. You better have the gospel of peace. Being a peacemaker, bringing peace into the lives of people, not strife. He says your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace, that you are ready to preach the gospel of the good news. The good news, and that will bring peace into the lives of people. People are tired of the bad news, how sinful they are, how messed up they are. How preach the good news of the kingdom, that God wants to heal them, deliver them, set them free. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith. You better have a shield of faith. You need to have some faith in this time. When the enemy comes against you, your battle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against the powers and rulers. And you need to have some faith to take your stand against it. You see, it's the just shall live by faith. Not by their riches or their wealth or their cars or houses. They shall live by faith, says the Bible. If there's no food, they are busy doing something. Again, I don't know, here in South Africa or something this week or whatever is going to happen, where they're going to stop the food. I don't know. The just shall live by faith.
Yes.
We do not live by the government. We do not live by the hand of people. We live by faith. So we need to have some faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows. Let me tell you, there are arrows flying in these days. Flaming arrows. People are saying this against that, and someone's angry with this one over that. We have got all these arrows flying. The Bible says by day and by night the arrows will be flying. You know, let me tell you, people are persecuting, saying things against one another. The arrows are flying. When you look, go onto the internet and you listen to what they are talking, the arrows are flying. We need to stop shooting arrows at one another and start targeting them at the enemy. And the Bible says that we must have a shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Where you know who you are in Christ, and when they say things or do things, you have a shield of faith that covers you against the arrows, against the things that people say. You have you can defend yourself and extinguish those flaming arrows. This morning, I don't know if you can hear in my spirit that I'm kind of agitated with what I'm seeing in the last few days. I mean, I'm quiet, I don't say much, but what I'm seeing is agitating me. How people are fighting and quarreling against one another. I'm not talking about the church, but all over, you see it. I just wish people will get out of that kind of gospel. He says, take the helmet of salvation. Know that you are saved. The helmet of salvation. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. You better have a knowledge of your salvation in these days. And you better have the Word of the Spirit, which is the sword, which is the Word of God. You better have that in your life. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests with this in mind. Be alert and always keep on praying. I think that is another cry of the Spirit today. With all kinds of prayers, stay alert and keep on praying. Keep on praying. Stop fighting and keep on praying. Stop talking about your neighbor and keep on praying. For all the Lord's people, pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel. Wow. This is what you must pray for me. And this is what Paul says. And this is so powerful. He says, pray also for me And that's what we need to pray for one another. Pray for one another. Because in this church, everyone is doing something for God. And it's so powerful. He says, pray for me. That whenever I speak, words may be given me. That God will give me a word. That He will give me something. When Bianca goes online, that God will give her a word. When Javi goes online, or Zandri, or Testimony goes online, that God will give them a word. That God will give me a word. Amen. And this is what Paul says. Give me so that I will be fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. Wow. Paul says, pray for me that I may preach it and declare it fearlessly as I should. Amen. That's how we should live. Fearless. We need to speak this gospel. If you have something buckled around your waist, you will be able to speak it fearlessly. If you have a breastplate and faith, and if you have all these things in place, you will be able to speak it fearlessly. 2 Timothy 3 and verse 1 to 4. I must finish, I know. Two more verses, two more scriptures, I think. Well, let me just run through it quickly. 2 Timothy 3 verse 1 to 4. He says, but understand this, that in the last days, there will come times of difficulty. In the last days, there will be times of difficulty. And it's not difficulty because of finances. It's not difficult because all kinds of things. It's because of people. He says, in the last days, there will be times of difficult for people who will be lovers of themselves. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless. Yo, this is heavy. This is what the Bible says people will be like in the last days. And when you go onto the internet and you listen to people and you see how they carry on, then you see. You see how people can kill one another and do not feel a thing. Listen to the next one. Heartless, unappeasable. I underlined that word. Unappeasable. That means nothing you do will ever please them. They will never be at peace. Unappeasable. Whatever you do, nothing will ever please them. No matter what you do, they're always complaining. Unappeasable. They will never be at peace. They always want more. Next one is slanderous. Always speaking negative, talking about people. Rudy was reading this week in James chapter 5, where he talks that the 3, where your tongue is like a fire set ablaze by hell. And who can control it? The Bible says slanderous. Without self-control. They cannot even control themselves. Sorry guys, I know this word. It's not praising and jumping. Brutal. Not loving good. Treacherous. Heavy words. Treacherous. Always trying to trick one another. Reckless. Swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Yeah. And this describes the day we are living in. He says in the last days there will be times of difficulty, and it will be because of people. You know, when people start, when you start endangering their finances, or what's the word? When you start putting them in a corner about their finances, their food, their children, their houses, they become offensive. They start fighting and quarreling because they are so busy fighting for their own lives. Because the Bible says it will be difficult if for people will be lovers of themselves. I believe that we are living in a time today where people love themselves so much that everything intimidates them. They love themselves so much that everything that comes against them, they fight and they quarrel about. They are so protective of themselves. They're so protective of their finances. They're so protective of their houses. They're so protective of their cars. They're so protective of everything that gives them comfort. Maar om stil te in hierdie NG Kerk volg. Corinthians 13 verse 5, I'm almost there. Examine yourselves, says the Bible. Examine yourselves to see whether you are in faith. Test yourselves. Here he comes again. Examine yourself. Test yourself. Do you not realize that Christ Jesus is in you? Test yourself. Do you not realize that Christ Jesus is in you? What must he say? What must he do? What must the Spirit that is in us do in a time when people are like this? He says, do you not realize that Christ Jesus is in you unless, of course, you fail the test? He says, test yourselves. Test yourselves. And see if Christ is really in you. That's how the Amplified explains. See if Christ is really in you. Or are you failing the test? Unless, of course, you fail the test. You see, if you test yourself, you must see for yourself that you are not failing the test of having Christ in you. You see, a lot of these things are work that we need to do ourselves. We need to focus on ourselves. We need to look at ourselves first before we look at others, before we judge others. We must take the plank out of our own eyes first so that we can see the splinter in someone else's eye. See, we are such lovers of life. Revelations 12 verse 11, I'm finishing. And they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they love not their lives even unto death. We said that we are lovers of ourselves. And the Bible says in Revelations 12, and that's the end of the Bible, where he talks about a remnant. Talks about a kind of people that will remain. And the Bible says, and they have conquered him. That's the enemy. They've resisted him. They've submitted themselves. They've conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they loved not their lives even unto death. We should stop being lovers of ourselves. We should stop being lovers of this life. You know, when I saw that song, and he has fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand, he's riding a white horse all across this land, and he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me? You know, it's a dying to self. Bible talks about we being lovers of ourselves. Paul says, die to yourself. Die to yourself. It's no longer I that live, but Christ that lives in me. Die to yourself and let Christ live in you. You know, when you die and Christ becomes more, you will move into the blessings of Deuteronomy 28. You will move into complete healing. You will move into complete authority. You will move into the greatness and in the power of God, where you die to yourself, less of you and more of Him. See, because we live lives today where it's just about me. What about living a life where it's about Him? Go and read Revelations 19. Verse 5, or read the whole chapter, and you will see. He talks about this rider on his white horse and the armies. and how the armies of heaven comes and they fight against the Antichrist and they defeat him. And he talks about the bride that makes herself ready, the bride that cleanses herself, the bride who has made herself ready. Let me tell you that there is a bride in these days that is making herself ready. And let us as a church, as His Heart Ministries, let us become a part of the bride that is making herself ready. And we will grow in character. And we will not be lovers of ourselves, but we will love God. Put Him first. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. And all these things shall be added. Amen. Amen. Father, we just come to You this morning. And Father, as a church, we submit ourselves to You this morning. Father, we give ourselves to You, not half-heartedly, not half-baked, but fully. We give ourselves to You. We surrender ourselves to You, Father. And we ask You, Father, to come and make us strong, firm, and steadfast. When the day of evil comes, that we will have some stuff buckled around our waist. And we will be strong and not be shaken, not be moved. Because we are not lovers of ourselves. But we love You, Father. And that we seek Your kingdom. We seek Your rule. We seek Your control in Jesus' name. Come, Holy Spirit, come and teach us. Come and teach us. Come and heal us. Come and restore us. So that we can become who You've called us to be in Jesus' name. Thank You, Father God. We praise You. We exalt You. We adore You. There's such a presence of the Lord here right now. Father, right now, remove our hearts of stone. Remove our hearts of stone. And give us a heart of flesh. A heart that can be broken. Like Hillsong sang that song, Lord, break my heart for what breaks Yours. Father, make our hearts tender again to hear Your word. Make our hearts tender again to change upon the unction of Your word and under Your anointing, that it will break our hearts for what breaks Yours. Lord, help us to feel Your heart, experience Your heart, know Your heart as His heart, that we will have Your heart, Father God. And Father, I ask You, strengthen me to preach Your word. Father, the true gospel. And Father, that I will boldly proclaim it. But Father, from Your heart. Because this is His heart, Father, Your heart. That this church will always reflect Your heart. It will never reflect our hearts and our lives or what we want. That it will always reflect Your heart. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, right now I release this anointing. I sense a powerful anointing. Father, I release this anointing over this church. Father, even those that cannot be here this morning, where they are watching this video later on, Father, I release this anointing over the church, over the body of Christ, Father. A heart that will follow hard after You. I release it, Father. I release it right now. Father, bring us to repentance. Bring us out of carnality, out of fleshly living. Bring us out of the natural into the supernatural. Into Your character, into Your will, into Your purpose, into Your plan. That it will no longer be I that live. That we will kill the I. That it will be no longer I that live, but Christ. No longer I, but Christ. No longer I, but Christ. No longer I, but Christ that lives in me. And He is the hope of glory. Not me, not my ability, not I, but Christ in me, the hope of glory. In Jesus' name. And Father, let Your glory be revealed in the earth. Like never before. We will be a bride that will make herself ready. In Jesus' name. Amen.